Praise the Lord. Thank you for coming to the Bible study. And we thank the Lord for the faithfulness of everyone coming. You come with your hearts, you come with your Bible, and you come with the desire and decision that you are going to learn and hear from the Spirit of God. And the Lord will bless you and turn around everything in your life for the better in Jesus' name. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for the series of studies we've been having in the Gospel according to St. Mark. And we thank you for the revelation of your truth and your word to everyone. Thank you for your Spirit guiding us into all truth, profitable truth, perfecting truth, purifying truth. We ask, O Lord, that today your word will do good in every life in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Tonight we're coming to Mark chapter 15. As we look at Mark chapter 15, we're reading from verse 33 to verse 41. Please open your Bible, Mark chapter 15, verse 33. And when the sixth hour was come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And then we're told in verse 34, and at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which is being interpreted, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And then in verse 35, we're told, and some of them that stood by, when they heard it, said, behold, he calleth Elias. And then in verse 36, and one ran and filled a sponge full of vinegar, and put it on a reed, and gave him to drink, saying, let alone, let us see whether Elias will come to take him down. And then in verse 37, and Jesus cried with a loud voice and gave up the ghost. Verse 38, and the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom. Verse 39, and when the centurion which stood over against him saw that he so cried out and gave up the ghost, he said, truly, this man was the Son of God. In verse 40, we're told, and there were also women looking on afar off, among whom was Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of James the Less, and of Joseph and Salome. Now verse 41, who also, when he was in Galilee, followed him and ministered unto him. And many other women which came up with him unto Jerusalem. Those are the verses we're looking at today. And the topic we're dealing with is so great salvation through his great suffering. He had a great suffering, great sacrifice to be our substitute, to be our savior, and to be our sin bearer, to be the final sacrifice that will be offered for sin, the sin of every individual, the sin of every family, the sin of every community, the sin of every nation, in fact, the sin of the old world. Here is the fulfillment of what John the Baptist had said by the Spirit of God, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. To do that, he had to suffer. To do that, he had to sacrifice. To do that, he had to become the Paschal Lamb, the sacrificial Lamb, the suffering Lamb, the slain Lamb, the smitten Lamb. It's great suffering. And through that, we have so great salvation. We're dividing the message today to three parts. Number one, the mystery of his sayings on the cross. He said some things on the cross, the mystery, the scriptures behind everything that is said on the cross. Number two, the marvel in the sanctuary after his cry. After he cried and he gave up the ghost, the mystery, the marvels of the things that happened. And then in point number three, the Messiah was our substitute on the cross. The Messiah, a substitute on the cross. Let's come to number one. As we come to point number one, we're looking at Mark chapter 15, verses 33 and 34. It says in verse 33, and when the sixth hour was come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And now in verse 34 it says, and at the ninth hour Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Mark records the first thing he said on the cross. And then we have Matthew, we have Luke, we have John, and the four evangelists, the four authors of the gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they reveal to us the seven sayings of Christ on the cross. And here is the first, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? I want to remind you once again that all the things that happened to Christ, from the time of the betrayal to the time of the arrest and to the time of the false witnesses and to the time of the judgment and to the time of his being whipped and being scourged and to the time of the spitting on his face and putting the crown of thorns on him and to the time of the crucifixion and the burial and the resurrection on the third day, everything had been predicted and prophesied, proclaimed in the scriptures. And so you will find what he said on the cross was already prophesied. Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. It says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Let us look at the seven sayings of Christ on the cross one by one. Number one now, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? We're looking at Psalm 22, verse 1. In Psalm 22, reading from verse 1, here we find exactly what Christ had said on the cross. He said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That's exactly what he said. It makes you to know that what David had written more than 1,000 years before, it didn't happen to him, but he wrote it concerning the Messiah. That's why Psalm 22 is referred to as the Messianic Psalm. A psalm written for the Messiah, the Christ, the Savior, who was yet to come. Look at that question, why hast thou forsaken me? Let's answer the question why. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 53 and we're looking at verse 6. Isaiah chapter 53, we're looking at verse 6. It says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. Look at this. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He has laid on him the iniquity of us all. And because our sins were laid on Christ. And God is of purer eyes than to behold iniquity. He would have forsaken us because of our sins. Now Christ was forsaken. And so when Christ said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? He was forsaken because he was bearing the load and the shame and the plague and the punishment of the sins of the whole world. Look at 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. In 1 Peter chapter 3, reading from verse 18, it says very clearly there what Christ has done and the purpose of what Christ has done and the reason why Christ was forsaken when he was dying on the cross. It says, for Christ also has once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God. That's the purpose. That's the reason why. Why hast thou forsaken me when he was making the final sacrifice? That he will bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. We come to the second saying now in Luke chapter 23, verse 34. Luke chapter 23, verse 34. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Forgive them, for they know not what they do. You see, Christ has brought forgiveness. And because of Christ's death on the cross, he brought forgiveness and he made intercession for all sinners. It says, forgive them, forgive the sinners, forgive the Jews, forgive the Gentiles, because the Jews and the Gentiles were involved in the crucifixion of Christ. And it says, for they know not what they do. You might say, I think they knew what they were doing. Christ said, for they know not what they do. They did not know the scriptures that affirmed what they were going to do. They did not know the decision of the Almighty God from the foundation of the world as concerning Christ, the death of Christ. They knew not what they were doing. They did not know that although they were thinking, they were getting rid of him. This was his way to the crown. This was his way to the coronation. The cross was the way to the crown. The cross was the way to coronation. They didn't know that. They didn't know that although they were jesting and mocking, this is the King of the Jews. They didn't know he was to pass through the pass and the gate of death to be our Savior and to be the sovereign Lord and to be our King of kings and Lord of lords, but they know not what they do. The point is, he prayed for them. Actually, forgiveness comes as a gift from Christ. Look at Acts chapter 5. We're reading from verses 30 and 31. Acts chapter 5, reading from verse 30. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom ye slew and hanged on a tree. In verse 31, it says, him has God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior. Him has God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior. Look at this. For to give repentance to Israel, it's the one that gives repentance. As people come to Christ, he makes them to repent genuinely. And then it says, and forgiveness of sins. He gives repentance and forgiveness of sins. Can we point out very clearly here the prayer of Jesus? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Only made forgiveness available. He didn't give them forgiveness automatically. There ought to be repentance. They still had to repent before the forgiveness of sins will come. That's why Jesus told his own disciples that they should go and teach all nations about repentance. That's why Acts chapter 2 and in verse 38 says, repent. That's why Acts chapter 3 verse 19 says, repent and be converted, because the time of refreshing then will come from the Lord. That's why it says God now commands all men everywhere to repent. That's why the Bible says God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. The forgiveness is not automatic. You know, I can go on sinning, I can go on doing evil, and Christ has prayed for me, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Repentance falls. After that, forgiveness. In fact, let me show you something in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 15. 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, we're looking at verse 15. Let's see that it says, who both killed the Lord Jesus, is referring to these people who crucified the Lord and their own prophets. They killed their own prophets and they have persecuted us. What do you understand by that? They killed the Lord Jesus, they killed their own prophets, and they have not repented. They have not turned away from their sin. They're still persecuting even the apostles and the preachers of the gospel. And they please not God, and they are contrary to all men. Look at the conclusion of that in verse 16. In verse 16, forbidding us to speak to the Gentiles that they might be saved, to fill up their sins always. That is, instead of repenting, instead of accepting, asking for the forgiveness and accepting that forgiveness from the Lord, they were going on to fill up their sins always, for the wrath has come upon them to the uttermost. What we're learning from the scripture is Christ prayed for us, and Christ prayed for everyone. Potentially, everyone can possess, everyone can receive forgiveness, but there must be repentance. These ones that were even responsible for the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ, they were not forgiven because they continued to perpetrate their evil, and they were contrary to all men, and they were living contrary to God and to Christ, and they were not pleasing God, and therefore the wrath of God is come upon them to the uttermost. Number one saying of Christ on the cross, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Number two, saying on the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Number three now, Luke chapter 23, and we're reading from verse 41. It says in verse 41, and we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing amiss. As we have read in Mark, you'll see that at the beginning, both of them were, you know, talking to Jesus. If you are Christ, you come down and also release us to come down from the cross. All of a sudden, one of them, there are two thieves, one of them turned around. He said, but we indeed justly. What is happening to us that we're crucified with this Jesus Christ, the Lord? We're not in the same category. He is just, but we are unjust. He is righteous, but we are righteous. For we receive the due reward of our deeds. He confessed. He said, we're wrong, and we're sinful, and we're evil. That's why we're crucified. But this man has done nothing amiss. And now in verse 42, after confessing that, he said unto Jesus, Lord, he called him Lord. He said, you are not a sinner. He said, you are not just a religious figure. He said, you are not like the people are saying about you. I accept you. I proclaim you. I receive you as Lord. Lord, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. He knew he was the king of the Jews and the king of the old earth, the king of kings and the Lord of lords. And he says, I know you have a kingdom, and I know your kingdom is coming. Therefore, remember me when thou comest into thy kingdom. Look at the answer of Jesus in verse 43. In verse 43, it says, and Jesus said unto him, verily I say unto thee, verily, truly, I say unto thee. Look at this, salvation has come now. Verily, I say unto thee. Look at this, forgiveness came to this man. Look at this, verily, I say unto thee, today shalt thou be with me in paradise. Hold on there, we'll learn something here. The man did not have the opportunity or the privilege of being baptized in water. But he believed in the Lord. He knew that this is the Lord. And the Lord said, although you are not baptized in water, your sins are forgiven. And I want to tell you, you have confessed already that you are suffering for your wrong deeds. But now you are forgiven. Today thou shalt be with me in paradise. You know, this man did not have the chance, the opportunity of taking the Lord's Supper. Do this until I come. If he had the opportunity, he would have taken the Lord's Supper, but he did not, because there was no opportunity. And yet the Lord said, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Can I tell you something? This man said, we have done wrong. And yet the wrong we have done, he could not come down from the cross and make restitution. There was no restitution. Why? There was no chance. He was dying, and they were not going to take him from the cross. Today shalt thou be with me in paradise. The point is the sacrifice of Christ, the shedding of the blood of Christ, the death of Christ brought salvation. Total salvation to this man. He didn't have chance to pray for another experience and to be baptized in the Holy Ghost and to have this and to have that. And yet Jesus said, today shall thou be with me in paradise. Can I tell you something? His body died eventually on the cross, and he was taken down and he was buried. I'm talking about the thief on the cross. And his spirit, his soul, went immediately to heaven and to paradise, which means then When a believer, a true believer dies, immediately is taken from earth and is taken to heaven. And today, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord will be saved, shall be saved. Today shall thou be with me in paradise. And look at number four now. It's in John chapter 19. In John chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 26. John chapter 19, we're looking at verse 26. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciples standing by, whom Jesus loved, whom he loved, he says unto his mother, woman, behold thy son. Woman, behold thy son. Let's learn something here. Number one, you know, when you read in John chapter 2 that Mary said, they have no wine. And Jesus said, woman, what have I to do with thee? There are people that will question, how did Jesus disrespect his mother? Calling the mother woman, it wasn't any disrespect at all. That was the mark of a real respect when she said woman. And the same thing here on the cross, you understand, he was thinking of the care of the mother. Now he was thinking of the provision for the mother, and instead of saying mommy or mother, remember, this is Christ. Remember, this is Savior. Remember, this is Lord of lords and King of kings. Woman, behold thy son. He was now giving the care of the mother to the disciple whom Jesus loved. And he was saying, woman, take this young man, John, as your son. He'll take care of you like your biological son. Look at verse 27. In verse 27, then said he to the disciple, behold thy mother. Behold thy mother. And that means, John, that's your mother. Take care of your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her unto his own home to be like a real biological mother. Can I tell you something? Christ was going away and was going to heaven, a far away place, and the mother will be here. Apparently, Joseph was not mentioned, the husband of Mary. Joseph had died, and Jesus did not leave the mother just like that. Have you known people that are traveling out of the country? They travel to Europe, they travel to England, they travel to America, they travel to Canada, they travel everywhere, and their mother, the widow mother, has no care, and they are not thinking about the mother. As Jesus Christ was going to the far country, was going to heaven, did not say, well, let her live by faith and God will take care of her, I'll be taking care of her from heaven. He committed the mother to the hands of John, and John took the mother to his own home. Let's learn a lesson from that. Whatever is happening to you, don't forget your mother. Don't forget your father, and take care of them. Honor your father. When you take care of your father, you take care of your mother. That is how you honor them. It is the first commandment with promise. Let's come to number five now. In number five is John chapter 19, reading from verse 28. In John chapter 19, verse 28, after this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, all things were now accomplished. He had the joy of fulfilling the scriptures. He had the joy of being obedient to the Father in every detail until the very end. And knowing now that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, says, I thirst. I thirst, that the scripture might be fulfilled. And look at Psalm 69, verse 21. In Psalm 69, verse 21, he was going to say that, I thirst, because he was going to fulfill the scripture. They gave me also gall for my meat, and in my thirst, they gave me vinegar to drink. He fulfilled the scripture, and he said, I thirst. And he gave him vinegar to thirst. You know what he's telling us? Like he thirsted, he is also expecting us now will thirst, will be thirsty for what he has brought and for what he has provided on the cross. Are you thirsty at all? I'm not talking about ordinary water. I'm talking about ordinary drink. Are you thirsty? Like Jesus said, if you're thirsty, he says in Matthew chapter 5 and in verse 6, Matthew chapter 5 verse 6, it says, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. He was thirsty on our behalf, and then he was given vinegar to drink. He suffered the pangs and the pain of thirst. But now he says that is to lead us to be thirsty. He says we should be thinking about what Christ has done, the sacrifice he made, the substitutionary death he died for us, and that should make us to ask the question, why? Why did he suffer? Why did all that punishment come upon him? And why was he so drained out of blood and water that he said, I says, it is to provide righteousness for us. And that righteousness that Christ has provided, we need to be thirsty for that. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Not only that, as we thirst and we get saved, we thirst and we get sanctified, and we're righteous and we're purified and we're godly from the inner man, we also thirst for the power of the Holy Ghost. In John chapter 7, reading from verse 37, John chapter 7, reading from verse 37, it tells us in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, he expects us to be thirsty. Thirsty of spiritual things and hungry for spiritual things. If any man says, let him come unto me and drink. If any man says, let him come unto me and drink. It tells us in verse 38, he that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Look at verse 39. In verse 39 it says, but this spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him should receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. Christ is now glorified. He died. He was buried. He rose on the third day. And he has gone to be with the Father, seated at the right hand of majesty on high. And because he's now glorified, the Holy Ghost is now available for everyone. And you can be filled, and you can be baptized, and you can be enveloped, and you can be endued with power from on earth. But you must be thirsty. I thirst, we thirst, and now we're saved. We thirst, we're sanctified. We're thirst and we're filled with the Holy Ghost. We're thirst and we have the refreshing of the Spirit in all fullness from heaven. Number six, we're considering the sayings of Christ on the cross. Number one, it says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Number two, it said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Number three, it said, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. Number four, it said, woman, behold thy son, and son, behold thy mother. Number five, I thirst. Number six, it is finished. Look at John chapter 19. We're looking at verse 30. John chapter 19, verse 30. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. It is finished. What's that? It. Our redemption. Finished, accomplished, and it is done. What's that? Our salvation, our sanctification, our blessings from on high, the giving of the Holy Ghost, all the sacrifice that Jesus ought to make, each, that is, total redemption and total salvation, salvation immediately now, and salvation all through our lives, and salvation till the end of life, initial salvation at the commencement of our Christian life, final salvation at the consummation of our Christian life. It is finished. Everything associated with salvation, canceling all the consequence of sin and destroying the works of the devil, salvation for the spirit, salvation for the soul, salvation for the body, it is finished. It's talking about a healing cure. It's talking about a deliverance. Everything that Christ ought to do for a total redemption, it is finished. I want you to look at that. It is finished. There's nothing else to be done. It's not that it shall still be done. Everything that ought to be done for your salvation, for your healing, for your sanctification, for your confidence in the Lord, for your protection, for your deliverance, and for your getting to heaven, the totality and the entirety of grace, and everything the Lord ought to provide for you is finished. All the victory you ought to have, all the dominion you ought to have, it is finished. It is not that something is yet to be done. Maybe you still have to go to River Jordan. You still have to go to a particular river to bathe yourself before this will happen. You still have to make some incantation, and you still have to repeat some things that some people are writing in the prayer books of deliverance. Then all your deliverance will be accomplished. It is finished. There is nothing yet to be done. There is nothing yet to suffer. It is done. It, everything, is, that means even now, then it says finished. It is finalized. It is accomplished. It is done. And it is provided. It is perfected. It is completed. Already everything is done. And therefore, anyone that needs to get saved now, there is nothing else you are waiting for. It is finished. Anyone that needs to get healed now, there is nothing you are waiting for. It is finished. Anyone that needs total deliverance and freedom, it is finished. It is accomplished already. It is provided already. And heaven has affirmed that everything is now available. Number 6 of the saints on the cross, it is finished. It is done. And because it is done, now you can have the privilege of having everything finalized and everything accomplished in your life. Look at Daniel chapter 9, verse 24. Daniel chapter 9, we're reading from verse 24. It says in verse 24, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people, look at this, and upon the holy city to finish transgression, to finish transgression, to finish, finalize transgression. All the price that ought to be paid for sin to be done away from your life, everything is done. And it says to finish transgression and to make an end of sins. That's what it meant when it said it is finished. All your sins finished. The consequences of sin finished. And the consequences here on earth and the consequences in eternity, everything finished. It is finished to finish transgression and to make an end of sins and to make reconciliation for iniquity and to bring in everlasting righteousness and to seal up the vision and prophecy and to anoint the Most High. Understand, it is finished. Right now, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Right now, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be sanctified. Right now, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be healed. Right now, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. Right now, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be totally set free. Why? Because it is finished. Number 7. Number 7, we're looking at Luke chapter 23. We're reading from verse 46. Luke chapter 23, verse 46 is telling us about the final word that Christ mentioned, that he uttered, that he cried out on the cross. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Into thy hands I commit my spirit. Into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. Having said thus, after he said everything he said, and total redemption has now been accomplished, he gave up the ghost, having said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Look at Psalm 31. In Psalm 31 verse 5, it tells us that this has also been written before Christ even came. It said, into thy hands I commit my spirit. Thou hast redeemed me, O Lord God of truth. And now that's exactly what a child of God ought to do. The Lord has left us an example. He has left us a pattern that everything in our lives now, from the moment you are saved until we see him in glory, we commit our souls keeping into the hands of the Lord. In 2 Timothy chapter 1 and in verse 12. 2 Timothy chapter 1, reading from verse 12. For the which cause I also suffer these things, talking about the persecution for the apostle, for the Christian. Nevertheless, I am not ashamed, for I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. Look at Paul the apostle. He said, when I came to the Lord, and then I saw that there'll be challenges, there'll be trials, there'll be temptation, there'll be persecution, there'll be affliction. I committed my soul and I committed my life. I committed everything in the Christian journey. I committed it to the Lord. My soul in particular. And I'm so sure it's in safekeeping. I am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. And Peter tells us in 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 19. 1 Peter chapter 4 verse 19. Here is what we're to do too. It says, wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing as unto a faithful creator. We commit our lives, we commit everything into the hands of him who is faithful, who is able, who is mighty, who is powerful, who will keep us until the final day. Those are the seven sayings of Christ on the cross. And I pray that the benefits and the blessings of those seven sayings on the cross will be yours, will be mine, will be ours, one by one and all together in Jesus' name. We're coming to point number two now. Point number two, the marvel in the sanctuary after his crime. The marvel in the sanctuary after his cry. We're looking at Mark chapter 15, and we're reading from verse 35. Mark chapter 15, verse 35. And some of them that stood by, when they heard it, said, behold, he calleth Elias. When he said, Eloah, Eloah, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? For them, it was like speaking in tongues. For them, it was like speaking in language that they didn't understand. And he said, he was calling on Elias. And then he says in verse 36, in verse 36, and one ran and filled a sponge full of vinegar and put it on a reed and gave him to drink, saying, let alone, let him alone. Let us see whether Elijah will come down and then take him down from the cross. In verse 37, verse 37, and Jesus cried with a loud voice and gave up the ghost. Verse 38, in verse 38, and the veil of the temple was rent, was torn in twain, divided into two from the top to the bottom. Look at that verse 38, from the top to the bottom. If it's from the bottom, somebody could have taken his scissors and then repeat from the bottom. But no, from the top to the bottom, there's no hand of any man involved in that. It was the supernatural, sovereign word and sovereign act of God. In this part, we're looking at three things. Number one, the misinterpretation of sinners around the cross. The misinterpretation of sinners around the cross. You see, they couldn't understand when Jesus said, when Jesus uttered those words, and therefore, because they didn't understand, they misinterpreted what he said. That wasn't the first time. Look at John chapter 12, reading from verse 27. John chapter 12, reading from verse 27. Now is my soul troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this cause came I unto this hour. Verse 28. In verse 28, Father, glorify thy name. Then came there a voice from heaven, saying, I have both glorified it, and we glorify it again. Look at verse 29. In verse 29, the people therefore that stood by and heard it said, it thundered. Others said, an angel spake to him. They misinterpreted, and they said, an angel spoke to him. In verse 30, it said, Jesus answered and said, this voice came not because of me, but for your sakes. And yet they didn't understand. In verse 31, now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. It tells us then in verse 32, and if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. This is exactly what was happening now. He was lifted up on the cross so that through that death, he will draw all men unto himself. Verse 33, in verse 33, this is said, signifying what death he should die. Verse 34, says, and the people answered him, we have heard out of the law that Christ abideth forever. That's true. Christ, after he set up his kingdom, Christ, after he has made the final sacrifice for our sin, Christ, after he has first become our substitute, the Lamb of God, the Paschal Lamb, and the sacrifice for sin, and then after his death, and after he rises from the dead, after he's gone to the Father, he'll abide forever. They said, we've heard out of the law that Christ abideth forever. And how sayest thou, the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? Number one, they misunderstood the sayings of Christ on the cross. Number two now, we're coming to Mark chapter 15, verse 37. Mark chapter 15, we're reading from verse 37. In verse 37, and Jesus cried with a loud voice and gave up the ghost. He cried with a loud voice and he gave up the ghost. The means of our salvation in Christ. Gave up the ghost, he died. That death is for our salvation. That death, the soul, the spirit, leaving the body for them to bury, so that on the third day, that body will rise up, and the soul, the spirit, going to the Heavenly Father, the separation of the soul from the body. That's the death, and it is for our salvation. In Romans chapter 5, reading from verse 6, Romans chapter 5, reading from verse 6. For when we were yet without strength, in our sin, in our iniquity, in our transgression, When we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. Look at verse 8. In verse 8, it says, but God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Verse 9 tells us, much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. It is the death of Christ and the blood is shed for us that makes us to be justified, that makes us to be forgiven, that makes us to be saved. And now it will go all the way and save us from the wrath to come. In verse 10, it says, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Verse 11 says, and not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now, this present time, now at this moment, now at this time when we believe, now in this our present life, we have now received the atonement. We have the atonement because Christ died for us. And whosoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. If you have not made that decision, if you have not come to that salvation, ready salvation, available salvation, the salvation that forgives you and makes you free, the salvation that makes you a child of God, here is a step you have to take in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10. Romans chapter 10. We're looking at verses 9 and 10. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shall believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. In verse 10, it says, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. It's now available for you, for me, for everyone. We have salvation, salvation from sin, salvation from evil in society, salvation from the world, salvation, deliverance from Satan, salvation, total freedom from all the consequences of sin. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9. Hebrews chapter 2, reading from verse 9. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of death. He gave up the ghost. He died for you and for me. And we see him, who was made a little lower than the angels for the suffering of sin, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God, look at this, that he by the grace of God, make this personal, he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. He bore it for you. He suffered for you. He died on your behalf. Tasted death for every man. In verse 10, it says in verse 10, for it became him for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, in bringing many sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. Perfect through sufferings. In verse 11, for both he that sanctifieth and they who are sanctified are all of one, for which cause is not ashamed to call them brethren, It tells us in verse 14. In verse 14, it says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself, likewise took part of the same, that through death," the death on the cross of Calvary, "through death he gave up the ghost, through death, after suffering and saying, 'It is finished, I commit my spirit into thy hand,' then he died. Through death he might destroy him that has the power of death," that is the devil. In verse 15, it says, "And deliver them who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage." Well, then, is the means of our salvation. His death is the means of our salvation, total salvation, complete salvation, present salvation, lifetime salvation, and consummated salvation, entire salvation for spirit, soul, and body. And it's available today for everyone. Number three, the ministry of his submission to all Christians. The ministry. He ministers to us. We can even say the ministration of his submission to all Christians. It tells us in Mark chapter 15, verse 38. Mark chapter 15, verse 38, "And the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom." You want to understand that there is nothing useless in the word of God, nothing redundant in the word of God, nothing unnecessary in the word of God, nothing we should overlook in the word of God. Therefore, this verse is important. The veil of the temple was rent, was torn, and it says from the top to the bottom. Why? How did that happen? It tells us in Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, look at verse 3. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 3, "After the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all." The holiest of all. That veil separated the Holy of Holies, the holiest of all, from the rest of the tabernacle. And at that time, only the high priest could enter into that Holy of Holies, into the holiest of all, once in a year, on the Day of Atonement. It wasn't open to all the members, all the people in the commonwealth of Israel. But now, because of the death of Christ, that veil that divided the holiest of all from the rest of the tabernacle, that veil was rent, was torn in two. That now the way is open for everyone to go into the holiest of all. Look at verse 8. In verse 8, it says, "The Holy Ghost, this signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest, while as the tabernacle was yet standing," at that time before the death of Christ, "the way into the holiest of all was not yet open," not yet available to all. And then we're told in verse 9, "which was a figure for the time when then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect as pertaining to the conscience." But look at verse 14 now. In verse 14, "How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal everlasting Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God." The way is now open, our conscience now purged, our lives now saved, and the consequences of all the past sins all cancelled, and the veil is now rent in twain, and now we can come into the holy place and also to the holy of holies, to the holiest of all, because the veil had not been rent. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 10 from verse 19. Hebrews chapter 10, reading from verse 19. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest. You see that? Because the veil has not been rent. Because the way is now open. It says now we have boldness, the boldness of faith, the boldness of assurance that Christ has paved the way, Christ has opened the door, Christ has rent the veil in twain. We now have the boldness of conviction and the boldness of confidence. Having now, brethren, therefore, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. It tells us in verse 20, it says, by a new and living way. This is not the old covenant now, it's the new covenant. By a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us through the veil. Through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. In verse 21, and having an high priest over the house of God. Verse 22 says, let us draw near with a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Now we have the privilege to enter into the holiest of all. Now you can come and you start from the outer court in figure of speech for salvation. And then you come to the holy place of the tabernacle, sanctification. And then you come to the Holy of Holies, the holiest of all, into the baptism in the Holy Ghost. And now he cleanses our lives. Outwardly now, we can be holy. And now he cleanses our inner man. Inwardly now, we can be pure and holy. And now he strengthens us in the inner man. And we can be superlatively holy and righteous and mighty and powerful, even in the inner man, saved, sanctified, and filled with the Holy Ghost. We can have the peace of God. We can have that purity of heart. And we can have the power of the Holy Ghost. All is available now because Christ opened the way and Christ opened the door. And we can now enter in through the blood of the Lamb. We come to point number three. The Messiah was our substitute on the cross. The Messiah was our substitute on the cross. We're coming to Mark chapter 15, verse 39. Mark chapter 15, and we're reading from verse 39. And when the centurion which stood over against him, that is against Christ, is talking about the position he stood and where Christ was crucified, and he could see Christ there, and he could hear Christ there. And when that centurion which stood over against just across where the cross was, when he saw that he so cried out and gave up the ghost, said, truly, this was the Son of God. Truly, certainly, assuredly, without any shadow of doubt, this was the Son of God. He's talking about the affirmation, the confirmation, the certainty, the assurance that what Christ had said, and these people, the priests and the high priest and the council and the members of the Sanhedrin, and all the religious leaders of Israel, they accused him of blasphemy. And they said he called himself the Son of God. The centurion, when he saw what had happened, and when he had the sayings of Christ on the cross, and when he had the final thing that he said on the cross, and he said, Father, into thy hands I commit my spirit. And then he gave up the ghost. When that centurion saw that, he said, everything this man said about himself was actually true. Truly, this man was the Son of God. Look at three things here. Number one is the Son of God. Number two is the Savior sent from God. Number three is the sacrifice acceptable to God. Number one, the Son of God. The Son of God. Look at Matthew chapter 27. In Matthew chapter 27, we're reading from verse 45. Matthew chapter 27, verse 45. And now, from the sixth hour, there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. Look at that. For 3 hours, total darkness all over the land. Christ, the Savior, dying on the cross. The light of the world, dying on the cross. Crucified on the cross. And when he died, it says, for 3 hours, from the sixth hour unto the ninth hour, there was darkness all over the land. Obviously, that sent a message to the whole land. And then in verse 51, it says, behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent. Look at all the marvels that happened, all the great things that happened at the point of the death of Christ. And then in verse 54, now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. Truly, this was the Son of God. Look at what he said. They feared greatly. We shouldn't fear now. We should believe greatly. We should appreciate greatly. We should marvel greatly. We should embrace greatly that this truly is the Son of God. And as we believe that this truly is the Son of God, that's how salvation will come. Look at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8. And we're reading from verse 33. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8. We're reading from verse 33. In his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. And who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. That's talking about Christ. His life was taken from the earth. And look at verse 35. In verse 35, it says, then Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him Jesus. Verse 36. In verse 36, and as they went on their way, they came unto a certain water, and the eunuch said, see, here is water. What does hinder me to be baptized? It says in verse 37, it says, and Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. The centurion and they that stood by, they said, truly, this was the Son of God. But they feared greatly. But this man said, I believe. We should go from fear unto believing. Look at all that has happened. And it happened according to the scriptures. I believe Jesus Christ is the Son of God. In verse 38, it says in verse 38, and he commanded the chariot to stand still, and he went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he was baptized. Now you believe, and as you believe that Jesus is the Son of God, your salvation comes. And after that, you keep on living by the faith of the Son of God. Galatians chapter 2, we're looking at verse 20. Galatians chapter 2, we're reading from verse 20. It says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and he gave himself for me. What he did on the cross of Calvary, he gave himself for me. We believe now he is the Son of God. Number two, truly, this is the Savior sent from God. Truly, this is the Savior sent from God. And let's look at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 5, verse 30 and verse 31. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 5, we're reading from verse 30. The God of our fathers raised up Jesus, whom he slew and hanged on a tree. Verse 31, it says, him as God exalted with his right hand to be a prince and a savior. To be a prince and a savior, for to give repentance to Israel and the forgiveness of sins. Now he is our savior. And what a savior he is, able to save to the uttermost. And that salvation is now available for you, for me, for everyone. He wants to save everyone. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2, we're looking at verse 3. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, and we're reading from verse 3, this is a good saying and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior. Verse 4, it says in verse 4, who will have all men to be saved. He'll have you to be saved. He'll have your neighbors to be saved. He'll have your friends to be saved. He'll have all the people in your family to be saved. That's why you should tell them, let them know, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. Look at verse 6. In verse 6, it says, who gave himself a ransom for all. He gave himself a ransom for all to be testified in due time. Titus chapter 2 verse 11. Titus chapter 2. It says in verse 11, for the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared. Look at this. To all men, you included, he has appeared unto all men. In verse 12, it says, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world. Looking in verse 13, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Our Savior, Jesus Christ, is your Savior. If he has not been, you can make him your Savior at this time. He will save you. All it takes is for you to turn away from sin, to repent from all your sins, and to receive him and to accept him as your Savior, that he took your sins away. Already he has said, it is finished. He has paid the ransom, the price for your salvation. Now in verse 14 it says, who gave himself for us, for me, for you, for everyone, for the whole of humanity, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself, and purify unto himself, and purify unto himself a peculiar people zealous of good works. Truly, Christ is the Son of God. Truly, Christ is the Savior sent from God. Truly, Christ is the sacrifice acceptable to God. The sacrifice acceptable to God. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 9, reading from verse 26, the sacrifice acceptable unto God. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26. For then, most he often have suffered since the foundation of the world. But now, once in the end of the world, he has appeared to put away sin. He has appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. By that sacrifice, what the Son of God did, by that sacrifice which our Savior, which he offered, he has put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Hebrews chapter 10, we're reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 10, reading from verse 12. It's telling us about what he has done. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, that sacrifice enough for all the sins of all sinners in all generations, because he offered that sacrifice for sins forever, he sat down on the right hand of God. Sat down on the right hand of God. Verse 14, in verse 14, now, for by one offering he has perfected forever them that are sanctified. It's now available. That sacrifice is offered. You can be saved. That sacrifice is offered. You can be sanctified. That sacrifice is offered. And everything that Calvary has provided can be yours. Look at Ephesians chapter 5, verse 2. Ephesians chapter 5, reading from verse 2. It tells us, and walk in love, as Christ also has loved us and has given himself. He has given himself for us. That's for you. That's for me. That's for every one of us. He has given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God. An offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. For a sweet smelling savor. It's acceptable unto the Lord. He's done everything that ought to be done. What's the result now? How can you have the result and the reward and the provision and the purchase of everything he did on the cross of Calvary? Romans chapter 10, we're looking at verse 13. In Romans chapter 10, we're reading from verse 13. From everything that he has now done, for whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's done. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be sanctified. It's done. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be healed. It is done. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be filled and saturated with the Holy Ghost, because he has purchased everything. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be filled and satisfied. Everything is now available. That whosoever is you, because salvation is now available, deliverance now available, healing now available, everything now available. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved, and he'll satisfy you with all the provision of the cross of Calvary. We thank the Lord for what he has revealed to us today, everything concerning your salvation. Everything concerning total salvation, complete salvation, entire salvation, everything has now been provided, and you can call, and you can call on the name of the Lord, and he will save you, he will sanctify you, he will fill you, he will satisfy you, he will deliver you, he will put all the blessings of redemption upon you. Let's rise up now and call on the name of the Lord because of what he has revealed unto us today. Remember what he said on the cross of Calvary? All those sayings on the cross of Calvary. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Because of you. because of you. Say, Lord, I thank you. You put all my sins on Christ. You put all my shame on Christ. You put all my punishment on Christ. You put all the perdition I should have gone through on Christ. That's why you forsook him, because he took my place. And then turn to Christ, say, Lord, I thank you. My perfect substitute, I thank you. My perfect savior, I thank you. Perfect captain of my salvation, I thank you. My perfect sin bearer, I thank you. You bore away all my sin. That's why you were forsaken. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Say, Lord, I thank you, because he prayed for you. And he's still praying for you today. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And as you will give yourself to the Lord and turn away from your sin and totally repent from every sin, he will forgive every sin you ever committed without leaving any grain of guilt or condemnation. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And then it says, today shall thou be with me in paradise. For everyone that believes, today your name will be in the book of life, in paradise, in heaven. And when you leave this world, your name has gone ahead of you already. The moment you believed, the day you believe, that same day your name is written in the book of life in heaven. But then when you leave this world, the minute you leave this world, you will get to heaven straight. Heaven straight. There will be no wasting of time. Your soul, your spirit will not be lingering in any river, whatever, anywhere, any forest, whatever. The moment you leave this world, you'll be with God in heaven. And then, woman, behold thy son. While Jesus was dying, he committed the care of his mother unto John, the beloved. You know, he cares for you. He cares for you. And now he's in heaven, and God will supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. He will not forget his own. He will care for his own. If when he was suffering, if when he was about to die, if when he was going through the agony of the cross, he remembered the care of his mother, how much more now? Is on the right hand of majesty on high, and is now in glory up on high. He remembers his own. He says, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. His care will be for you. He will abundantly provide for you. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and have life more abundantly. If he cared for his mother, the natural mother at that time, he cares for everyone now. And he says, I thirst. He knows your thirst. You're thirsty. You want the blessings of the Lord. You're passionate about that. You're desirous about that. You say, I feel dry. I feel diminished. I feel weak. I feel drained. I feel so thirsty. I seem I'm in a wilderness. I thirst. He'll give you the water of life to refresh you. His water, his blessing will come upon you like refreshing dew and rain. If you tell him, I thirst after righteousness, I thirst after the fullness of God, I thirst after the grace of God, I thirst. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, after the fullness of redemption, for they shall be filled. They shall be satisfied. They shall be refreshed. And then he said, it is finished. It is finished. Nothing else to be done. It is finished. Tell the Lord, I know it is done. I know it is accomplished. I know it is provided. I know it is done. It is finished. It is mine. Salvation is mine. It is finished. Healing is mine, it is finished. Perfection is mine, it is finished. Holiness is mine, it is finished. Total redemption is mine, it is finished. And deliverance is mine, it is finished. All the blessings coming from Calvary, they are all mine, it is finished. And the glory of God, the grace of God, the provision of God coming from the throne of God, all are mine, it is finished, it is finished. And now, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. Can you do that? Are you suffering in well-doing? Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. I commend my soul. I commend my salvation. I commend my destiny. I commit my life, my soul, my destiny into the hands of the Lord. The Lord will keep safe and secured everything you commit into his hands. I commit my family into your hand. You'll keep your family. I keep my child. I give my wife. I give my husband into your hand. I commit everything I have into your hands. The Lord will keep everything you commit into his hand. And I commit my destiny into his hand. He'll keep everything. Commit the keeping of your soul and the commit of every precious possession into the hand of the Lord. He will keep you. And now we know, we understand that this is the Son of God. Lord, I believe he is the Son of God. He is the Son of God. Believe that. He is the final sacrifice. Believe that. He is the substitute, your substitute. Believe that. He is the Savior of the world, and your own Savior. Believe that. And as you believe, that you say truly, that you say certainly, that you say without any shadow of doubt, that you say from the depth of my heart, I believe Christ is my Lord. Christ is the Son of God. Christ is my Savior. Christ is my sin bearer. Christ is my substitute. Christ is the final sacrifice. He's taking everything away. As you believe that in your heart, then it will be what you believe him to be concerning you. Being the Son of God, he'll make you the Son of God too. Being the sin bearer, he'll bear all your sins away. Being your Savior, he'll save you from every sin and all the consequences of sin. And being your substitute, he will take everything, every evil thing that shall have come upon you, take everything away. There'll be a great exchange that you transfer your sin, you transfer your punishment, you transfer your yoke, and you transfer the curse, and you transfer the evil into his son, and he will transfer his righteousness and his redemption, and he will transfer every good thing in his grace into your life. Because you believe, there's that great exchange that makes him to be your great substitute. What you believe him to be, he will be in your life. And he is your king, and he is your Lord, and he is the final sacrifice. Your final sacrifice. Believe on him. What you believe him to be, he will be for your life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you this moment. We thank you for opening our eyes. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you, Lord, for everything you bore for us on the cross of Calvary. Thank you for making it come afresh and come alive in our lives today. Everything you said concerning yourself, everything you said concerning your suffering, everything you said concerning the believing sinner that comes to you at that time, at this time, at any time, and every time. Thank you, Lord, for making us understand that God forsook you because of us. My God, Why hast thou forsaken me when our sins were laid on you? Now I pray that everyone here, everyone listening, everyone who was still listening, who have not had the confidence and the faith and the assurance that their sins were laid on you, I pray that it will be theirs now, the conviction from heaven, the assurance from heaven that you bore everything away. That's why you were forsaken, so that we can be remembered. And Lord, I pray that the forgiveness you have prayed for, as you said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I pray that that forgiveness, that redemption, that freedom from sin will be ours in Jesus' name. And as you have said, for that thief who believed on the cross, even before water baptism and before restitution and before anything, you said, this day today shall thou be with me in paradise. Lord, I pray that you give assurance to everyone now that as we believe in you, as we believe on you, and we put all our faith on you, Lord, I believe that you will convince everyone that now their names immediately, instantaneously, their name gets into the book of life. And when a believer dies, you remind us of the confidence we have, the assurance we have, that that same moment, that very moment, that person goes to heaven because the name is already there in heaven. Lord, we thank you because you are the one that cares and you have compassion. As you said, woman, behold thy son, and son, behold thy mother. I pray, Lord, you give us the conviction that no matter where we are and no matter the need in our lives, our God will supply all our needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Supply every need in every life in Jesus' name. And as you have told us that everyone who thirsts, your karma, and you fill us, you refresh us. I pray, Lord, that all people who are feeling dry, who are feeling thirsty, who are feeling weary, who are feeling hungry, I pray that you replenish their lives, you refresh their lives, and the water of life will come in their soul, in their spirit, in their mind, and you refresh them physically and naturally and spiritually and emotionally in Jesus' name. Oh Lord, I'm asking for everyone that everything you said on the cross will be now a bona fide property, something that we know we have, and we know it is finished, we know it is accomplished, we know it is done, and it will not be undone again, it will not be reversed again. Everything you have finished, accomplished on the cross of Calvary, make it the purchase of everyone and the possession of everyone now in Jesus' name. And now, Lord, everything we commit unto you, our spirit, our soul, our mind, our salvation, our destiny, our journey, our pilgrimage, everything we commit unto you, you will keep until that perfect day in Jesus' name. And Lord, now we believe, as we believe with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind, that Christ is the Son of God, that Christ is our Savior, that Christ is the final sacrifice. I pray all the benefits of the Son, all the benefits of the Savior, all the benefits of the final sacrifice, you make to come upon every one of us right now. I pray, Lord, our Christian lives will be a life of victory, a life of conquering, a life of joy, a life of the manifold blessings of God all through our lives in Jesus' name. I pray, Lord, you'll confirm your blessing upon everyone. You'll confirm the glory, your goodness upon everyone. And Lord, we pray we'll come to the brighter side of the cross of Calvary. And our lives now will be bright. Our lives will be beautiful. And our lives will be filled with the blessings of Calvary. We thank you, Lord, because we know you have answered. We will never be the same again. Thank you, Lord, for the answer. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And the people of God said, Amen.